I invite Sir to share his thoughts with us on this unique form of divine culture which he has envisioned for Vivekananda Institute of Professional Studies. Sir, please.
Good morning to all of you, and a happy Guru Purnima. When I say Guru Purnima, means Guru Devo Bhyo Namah. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. The spirit of the teacher, Guru Govindo Khade Kaake Lagun Paaye, Balihari Guru Aapke Jin Govindiyo Milaye. Guru Ka Mahatva, Guru Ki Mahima. Guru Shabd Hi Jo Hai Apne Aap Mein Uska Gurutva Jo Hai, Uska Gurutva Karshan, Uski Gravity, Uska Apna Akarshan, उसके ज्ञान की वजह से, उसके ज्ञान के कारण है. गुरु वो है जो ज्ञान जिसने अर्जित किया है और जो ज्ञान दूसरे को देने में सक्षम है, जिस वो जो पात्र है. केवल सुपात्र ही गुरु बन सकता है. गुरु हर व्यक्ति गुरु का अधिकारी नहीं होता है. एज ए सिंबल ऑफ गुरु, बिकॉज ऑल ऑफ यू आर सिंबॉलिक इंडिविजुअली एंड कलेक्टिवली ऑफ द गुरु, एज हैज बीन राइटली स्टेटेड बाय द अर्लियर स्पीकर दैट द गुरु डिस्पेल्स इग्नोरेंस. Guru instills that hope and lets that hope, that kindles that hope. Guru is the one who ignites that initial spark in you. And then, of course, it's for the deserving ones to add on to that. So, in all of you, In all of you, as a symbol of all of you, symbolically, I offer my reverence and regard, and I offer my prayers at the holy feet of the Guru, and as a symbol of all of you, as the senior most teacher, I invite Professor Pandey to come to the stage. I'll offer him flowers. And the senior most guru is being respected here. Let's show our reverence to him, because he virtually qualifies to be a guru. So this is an honor being bestowed on all of you, and he represents the repository of knowledge. There have been instances which has touched my life very deep. I have seen many gurus, you know, their illustrative life, from their illustrious life. And a few names come to me quite handy. How many of you have heard Dhanna Bhagat? There was one Dhanna Bhagat. Have you heard of him? Dhanna Bhagat. He was a spiritual guru. He didn't deal with the physical world. He always lived in the state of realm of spirituality, the inner knowledge, the knowledge of the self. And one of his disciples, an ardent disciple, I must say, ardent disciple in the sense that he did adhere to the dictates of his guru. I'm talking the post-partition days, earlier to that, pre-partition days. In pre-partition days, in the outskirts of Lahore, there lived a guru named Thanna Bhagat. He was blind by birth. He had a disciple whose name was Ram Tirth. And Ram Tirth belonged to a very poor family, could ill afford education. But still, in spite of all odds, Ram Tirth used to go to the school regularly. He was punctual. But then, due to stark poverty, he could not pursue his school studies. And at one point of time, his parents told him to engage in some vocational things and to add to the family income by learning something, sitting at a shopkeeper's shop and do some salesmanship, or a petty hawker, or any other job they wanted him to be gainfully engaged so that he also becomes another earning member of the house. But then he had an irresistible quest for knowledge. Irresistible quest for knowledge. And he approached the headmaster of the school. He had the courage. He says, "I want to study, but my parents cannot afford the fee of the school." And then the headmaster of the school says, "My child, don't discontinue studies because of financial constraints. You study with us and I'll pay your fee per month." So the headmaster assured him, but having been assured, yet he was not sure whether to accept his gratification in the form of fee or not. Because any gratification results in some kind of bondage, some kind of gratitude. So Ram Tirth, as a child, reached out to his guru, whom his family followed as a guru. He was a family guru. And he was known as Thanna Bhagat. He used to live in the outskirts of Lahore. And when he approached and said, "Guruji, that headmaster has assured that he will be paying my tuition fee and my parents don't have to bother and he wants me to continue with my studies, what do I do? Does the headmaster have an ulterior motive behind this? Shall it not create a bondage between me and the headmaster, because I don't want to be obligated to anybody?" And Thanna Bhagat said, "My child, he is a selfless teacher. He has no axe to grind. You can readily accept his gratification, because he wants to render selfless service." and then he approached, in all humility, the headmaster of the school. He said, "Now my guru has permitted me, my kul guru, or my family guru has permitted me to accept this gratification of my tuition fee being paid by you." And then he kept on and pursued his studies till the schools. And during this course only, he was getting physically very weak, undernourished. He was not getting any kind of nutritional diet, and each day his constitution was becoming weaker. And his constitution was getting weaker. One of the vendors, milk vendors, he offered him milk free of charge. He says, you take milk because you are a bright student. I am told you are the, you stand first always in the class. So as a gesture, I can offer you free milk. You take free milk from me so that you make for your nutritional deficiency. Yet this boy, as innocent as he was, he still approached Dhanna Bhagat and he again told him, Guruji, that milk vendor wants to give me free milk to take care of my body's nutritional needs. Should I accept it? Dhanna Bhagat again said he has no extra grain. He feels pity on you. He is a very kind vendor. He sees in you a bright spark. He sees that you will one day you will rise and you will bring name and fame to the locality and to the vicinity and to the neighborhood. So he sees in you his pride. So that's why the milk vendor also offer you free milk for you. And then he started taking free milk from the vendor, of course with gratitude again. One day, this boy became the first lecturer in English literature in Christian Foreman College, Lahore, and he was the first Indian to have this distinction of being a scholar of eminence and having been appointed straight after doing his master's degree. He was straight appointed as a lecturer when most of the lecturers at the time were British. In Christian Foreman College, he was the first Indian to be conferred with this honor of lecturership in a purely dominated faculty by the British. So how much intense faith you have in a guru. Guru Dakshina is another book which written by Mahadevi Verma. Geesa was a kindergarten child who used to attend her classes in the outskirts of Allahabad called Jhusi. And the bond between the teacher and the taught was so intense that when Mahadeviji said, now my children, we will have a summer break. This child, without giving a second thought, he ran out for his village and begged for a watermelon from the village vendor. I said, you're their son, so in village you are known by your father's name or your grandfather's name, and you are such and such saint son, and why in such a desperate hurry? I want money in return. He said, rest assured, my parents have gone to the fields, and after they come back, I'll pay each one of your penny. I'll repay you. Until then, you keep my shirt. So he mortgaged his shirt, took a huge piece of watermelon, and ran fast so that the class is not over. And before the class could be concluded and final farewell could be bid by Mahadevi Urmaji, he placed that watermelon at the feet of the guru, Mahadevi Urma herself. And she said, "What? Where is your shirt?" "Well, I mortgaged it to the local vendor." "But why?" He said, he had tears in his eyes, rolling down tears. He said, "But because we'll be meeting after 2 months, and you have taught us so much. We have learned so much from you. You have been so kind, so generous. You have always been giving. and you are not taking anything from us. That kind of gratitude. And she then wrote a book. Guru Dakshina was her first novel which she wrote. Then of course later on she got the Gyanpith Award on her Yama. So like this there are many many examples where Guru we followed and literally has led you from the pangs of ignorance to freedom. Freedom from bondages or poverty, hunger, ignorance. So to qualify to be Guru, it requires a lot of sacrifice. Because not many of us qualify to be Guru. We acquire, of course, qualification to qualify to be teacher. And as was rightly asked during one of the interviews for a teacher in education, was Dr. Radhakrishnan an educationist? And each one of them invariably said, I happened to chair that interview, and everyone said, yes, Radhakrishnan was, Dr. Jagdish Sen was an educationist. But that was not true. That was not true. Zakir Hussain was only, he only tried to implement basic education which was originally thought of by Mahatma Gandhi. So the original idea came from Mahatma Gandhi, that of basic education, about hygiene, about personal care, about learning the initial alphabets, literacy, basic literacy. Idea came from Mahatma Gandhi and not from Zakir Hussain. So most of us, we call ourselves professors, assistant professors and assistant professors, but we are most of the time repetitionist. We are not made any original contribution to whatever we have crammed out from our books and whatever we have learned so far. Whatever part of that knowledge has been committed to our memory, we simply try to pass it on as a package to our students. We don't make any original contribution, because after you have done your doctoral research, you say, here comes and I rest on my laurels and it is the last. So stagnation should not take place. Somewhere I find many times I get disappointed. As an observer, as I observe, as a third party, are we progressing? Are we going from truth to higher truth? Are we trying to establish the ultimate truth? Or are we establishing ourselves in the ultimate truth? Are we being truthful to ourselves? Are we being honest to ourselves? That whatever knowledge we are imparting is something different than what is available in the books. If one was to read from the books, then perhaps any student would make one or two readings of the book and acquire that knowledge. But that knowledge shall not be his or her knowledge. One of the examples given in Mundaka Upanishad scriptures, it says that apara vidya jo hai, वो चारों वेद हैं, उसमें वेदांग हैं, जितनी शब्द राशि है वो शब्द राशि है, वो ज्ञान नहीं है। तो ये सब जितना है ना, जितनी बुकिश नॉलेज है। और अंगिरा ऋषि ने शौनक को पूछा था कि यदि चार वेद और वेदांग मिला के सब ज्ञान नहीं है, शब्द राशि है, तो ज्ञान क्या है? तो कहते हैं जो अधिगम्यत है, जो अनुभूति में परिणित हो जाता है, कहते तोता जो है उसको गायत्री का मंत्र पढ़ा दो आप, वो गायत्री मंत्र करता रहता है, लेकिन वो ही डजंट बिकम द नोअर ऑफ द ट्रूथ। वो गायत्री मंत्र पढ़ता है, वो हम भी पढ़ते हैं रोज, किताबों से पढ़ते हैं, हमको कुछ याद हो गया है, कुछ हम लोग गिरते पढ़ते सीखे हैं, हम उसी को वो अपना जो नॉलेज है उसको पास ऑन कर देते हैं बट नो ओरिजिनल कंट्रीब्यूशन इज बीइंग मेड वी आर नॉट ट्रूली आई मीन रियलाइज दैट दैट रियलाइजेशन हैज टू सेट इन And I'll not deviate from the main subject of creating a spiritual culture in VIPS. Why is it necessary? Because I see most of the students coming from broken families, daily dejected, disgusted, hopeless. And many of them didn't have the benefit of adolescence health. They don't get proper guidance. They are out of school and they come straight to the college. And they have a very perverted definition of freedom. So freedom of what? Freedom to what extent? It's our bounden duty as an institution to tell them this is what is freedom. The freedom of thought. Freedom of expression, freedom of movement, but that are your fundamental rights, but there are corresponding duties aligned to it. And how can you become a responsible citizen is the duty of each one of you as a teacher. Because when you go beyond your little self and think of human welfare, then perhaps you are creating assets, national assets, and that's what a primary objective of an institution should be, to create national assets. Children are our supreme assets, and those supreme assets, they can only become if we add on some skills or employability skills in over and above what knowledge is being dispensed to them in the classroom. Beyond the classroom. How many of you are atheist? How many of you are atheist? Those who don't believe in God. And those who believe in themselves and no God. Can anyone have the courage to raise hand and say, no, I'm an atheist and I say I don't want to believe in God? That there's some kind of creature called God? Can anyone of you all have faith in God? You all have faith in God. So then where is the divinity? वो दिव्यता कहाँ है? उसको ढूंढना है ना? उन्हीं देख रहे हैं ना हम? If you are all God fearing, if you have manifested the divinity within, if you realize that we are something else than this body, then maybe each one of us at one point of time or the other must have offered prayers. Maybe you are sick, on a sick bed, maybe you are in distress, maybe you are frustrated with life, you are dejected. There's no career advancement, you're stagnating, and there you come to a knot and you say, here I'm confused completely. And when confusion takes over, you want somebody to come and instill that hope in you, not to give up, but to continue with your struggle to liberate yourself. A spiritual culture, when I say, lifts you beyond your little self. I have demonstrated this earlier also when I was on the doping commission of Asiad 82 Games. There were three members of the doping commission. And our primary objective was to detect steroids and hydrocortisosteroids in the urine samples of the athletes who were competing. And two instances which came, which almost shook me, which almost shaken my conscience and said, there exists God in all of us, in all beings. Everyone's heart is his abode. I came to believe those two instances in my life. One was when P.T. Usha was competing for 400 meter sprint. It was a hurdles race, 400 meters. And when P.T. Usha came, she was in line of the many Asian countries, and the moment she started running, the entire jam-packed 75,000 spectators in Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium, they started shouting, "P.T., back up, and please keep up, keep up, keep up, keep up," and they kept on encouraging. "Keep it up, keep it up, keep it up," as if they were running with her. And the moment she came first and she won the gold medal, all 75,000 spectators, jam-packed Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium, stood on their feet and identified with them so the achievement of P.T. Usha, as if each one of them has been given a gold, as if each one of them won the gold medal. Now that's where you transcend your limited self and you identify yourself with the performer. You have performed the best. We are with you in your achievement. And when she stood on the highest pedestal and when the national anthem was played, each one of our Indians' head was held high and we all started reciting the national anthem as a chorus. What happens then? We are not P.T. Usha, but her accomplishment, her achievement, we all took pride in that, because we just transcended our limited self and we saw her accomplishment is our accomplishment, collective accomplishment. So let's believe in collective joy, in collective accomplishments, in togetherness, that P.T. Usha's one accomplishment made all 75,000 Indian spectators proud and a billion plus population, 100 billion plus population proud of her accomplishments. Even today she has gone in the annals of athletic history. So also there was another one who was in the shot put. And the Iranian was competing with a shot put, you know. His name was Bulvinder Singh. So he was declared a gold medalist, but then finally he was disqualified, but because his urine samples failed. So everybody was crestfallen, as if we have lost gold. So when the spirit transcends its limited self and goes beyond yourself, your limited self, and reaches out for human welfare, then think you are growing. Your spirit grows, your spirit expands, or else you are contracting. And once you contract, degeneration begins, cardiomyopathies begin. You start stops functioning, your brain stops functioning, you as an organization stop existing. So I want each one of you to be a harbinger of a spiritual culture in whatsoever manner, because each one of us must be offering his or her prayers at home. Let's make these prayers an integral part of each one of the students who are coming here. Let's try to ascertain from each one of the students, and let it be class teachers, you know, responsibility to know as to how, what, which God do they worship at home, or what prayers do they worship at home? Do they go to the Gurdwara? Do they go to the temple? Do they go to the church? It doesn't matter. But must they ignite? Must they ignite that immortal spark which besides getting you material knowledge, it adds on to your spiritual dimensions? Then you just don't talk of matter, you talk of things beyond matter. You don't talk of physics or the physical existence, you talk of the metaphysical existence. And how much serenity lies there, how much peace and bliss it touches you from very close. So let's have a pool. Our students, drawn from across the disciplines, and let's try to touch their hearts, and let's try to treat them as humans, reach out to them as humans and as kind-hearted teachers. You are just not teachers, you are healers. Your role as healers, you are to be soothers. You should not be simply limited to the classroom teaching. It should go far beyond that. Understanding the child's psychology, looking at the family background, instilling them in hope, showing them a spiritual path, because it is always the ultimate key to success. When somebody stays in form, I was in form till the age of my 55 years. I was one of the finest medical practitioners, uncomparable with anyone in the vicinity. Because at that time, I was in constantly touch with the live wire. Then came social service and many other distractions, and they took me away from it. I became a medical professional out of form. And the rest of the professionals started taking my place. So is the case here. The old order changes, yielding place to new. Whenever there's a competition, think he or she is in touch with the live wire, constant touch with the live wire. And that is enabling him or her to stay in form. You get out of form, such and such athlete was in the best of form till such and such date and is now out of form. What is a form and what is that out of form? If you want you to be in form, you're also remaining constant touch with the live wire with a regular flow of energy. And for that, there's always a teacher. A teacher teaches you with sympathy, and nature teaches you with vengeance. Teacher teaches you with sympathy. Nature teaches you with vengeance. Natural calamities. Many things come and they teach humanity a lesson. So let's be kind, be generous, have a learning aptitude and not the attitude. Let's not arrogate ourselves, let's not say, oh, we are the last word, I am the last word. You should always strive to be the last word. And let the whole world recognize it. Let these things not come from an unrecognized quota. I mean, you say I am the best in my house. You may be, maybe you are. But then you need to prove to the world that you are the best. So on this Guru Purnima day, let's resolve to create a spiritual culture where we coexist together and we live like living beings, not half dead. For most of the time, we are not really what we should be. It's a pastime. Yes, we need to have breakfast, we need to have lunch, we need to have an afternoon siesta, we need to have some gossips, we need to wind up, go homes, interact with our family, look after their welfare, do some household chores, do it. I don't say that. But please do create an inner space where you find, yes, if I touch that space, I am into a state of total bliss. And from there, he showed you the path, he showed you the path that leads to the ultimate truth of self-realization, self-introspection. And that's how I thought on the Guru Purnima day. Let it be a day dedicated to all those students who are reposing their faith in this institution named after the Prophet and the Pathfinder, Swami Vivekananda. And let's practice his precepts. And I'm not averse to taking them around the religious places and bringing them close to the gurus who are virtual realized souls. There are very many people who, if they touch you, you feel blessed. I've been to many such places. There was a head in the Bangla Sahib Gurdwara. I went to him with Sardar Bhutta Singh. And amazingly, he gave us big laddus, oversized laddus. Bhutta Singh was at that time was the deputy railway minister. I see a miracle happening. He said, "Bhutta, I need some of your wagons, you know. Why do you need that?" He said, "I want to transport some marble for building new gurudwaras." So it will be done, but railway's damage itself is very heavy. So you need to get it transported quickly. If you don't really unload it at the railway station, maybe the damage is manifold than the cost of the marble itself. And while we are sitting there, there comes another Sikh gentleman. He says, "I live in Iran and I've got a chassis here for a truck, but since I am not settled in India, I am settled abroad, so I want to donate it to the Gurdwara." So he said, "Bhutta Singh, you arrange for the wagon and he arranges for the road transport. So the marble will be transported because his will. He wants it to be done. He wants it to be accomplished." There are very many such examples that I can give you. If you really go to the people who are realized souls, they really touch you. And their one touch will make you gold. So let's try and create a spiritual culture by which not only you feel blessed, but the students who are studying here in Vivekananda Institute of Studies also feel blessed, and they should feel that much more than the bookish knowledge, much more than the syllabus, they have been taught values which will last them their lifetime. Thank you very much.